Now, I've given you an example here of basically an alkyl halide with a nucleophile. Let's use the Big Daddy flowchart to figure out if this what mechanism this would be. So let's go ahead and ask our first question. Notice that my nucleophile is NaOAT. Is that negatively charged or is that neutral? For those of you that said neutral, you're forgetting that sodium can dissociate. So what it's actually going to look like is like OET negative, so that's going to be a negatively charged nucleophile. That's going to go down the left-hand side of the flowchart, okay? So let's go to step two. Step two is NaOAT one of my bulky bases? No, okay? We have a list of bulky bases. NaOAT is not one of them, so I'm just going to say no. Let's go to my third question. What type of alkyl halide do we have? Or what type of leaving group? Well, this carbon right there is attached to two other carbons, one, two, so this would be a secondary alkyl halide. So do we know the mechanism now? No, we have to ask one more question. The last question is, I'm just going to put it down here, is my base a better nucleophile or a better base? So for this, you have to remember, what were the strong bases? Is NaOAT one of those strong bases? Yes, it is. Remember that one of the strong bases was oxides. Oxides have the general formula of OR negative. And that's exactly what we have. We have OET, which is an ethyl group, negative. So this is an oxide, so this is going to favor E2. All right? Cool. So now we've got E2. Now we have to figure out, okay, how do we actually draw the mechanism for this, and how do we predict the products? Do you guys remember what the first step of E2 is? Figure out how many different beta protons I have, okay? So what do we got? We've got two different beta carbons. Let's say this is beta 1, and let's say this is beta 2. Okay, those are my two different options. Do both of them have hydrogens on them? Yes, they both do. On the green one, I've got a hydrogen towards the front and a hydrogen towards the back. On the red one, I just have a hydrogen towards the back. Okay? So are we ready to eliminate yet? We have to ask ourselves one more question. Now that we know all of our beta protons, which is three, how many of them could actually react in an E2 reaction using the anticoplanar rule? Remember, you always have to think of that rule. The answer is two of these could react. I could eliminate in the green direction with this one right there, and I could also eliminate in the red direction using that one right there. The reason is because my chlorine is facing towards the front, so I can only eliminate with a hydrogen that's facing towards the back. Okay? So now that I know that, let's go ahead and draw one of the mechanisms. We don't have to draw both. But let's just draw one of them and then predict the products. So the mechanism would be three arrows, just like it always is. Let's say I'm taking off the red H. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to dump my electrons into the bond between the alpha and the beta, and then I'm going to kick out my Cl. Okay? So what that means is I'm going to have two different products possible. I'm going to have a product possible where I eliminate where I just did. So it would be a double bond right there with now no Cl, I don't have to draw that, and a methyl group facing down like that. Now, why is it important that I drew my methyl group on a stick? Because remember, now this is trigonal planar. If I draw it on a wedge, that would look like I have no clue what I'm doing. Okay? I would kind of look like an organic noob, and you don't want to look like a noob when you're trying to get points from your professor. So that's the way we would draw that product. Obviously, I would have my Cl negative leaving group. But there's also another product I could have gotten. The other product would have been if I eliminated up to the green hydrogen, and that would have given me a product that looks like this. A double bond there, and let me just straighten that out a little bit. And that methyl group would still be on the wedge. Why am I drawing it on the wedge here? Because that carbon is still tetrahedral because it still has an H on it. So that is a carbon with four different groups around it, so that one should be drawn as a tetrahedral. All right, so now we've drawn our two different products. Are they both going to be formed in equal amounts? No. It turns out that Zaitsev's rule explains, just look down here, that we will always favor the more substituted thermodynamically stable product. Now, what the hell does thermodynamically stable mean? I know that whenever you bring like thermodynamics or kinetics, things get confusing. It just means overall which one's going to have the least energy, which one is going to be the overall most stable at the end. But guess what? We know how to figure this out. because we can just use the alkene stability rules to determine that. So, out of these two double bonds, which of them is going to be more stable and which one of them is less stable? What do you guys think? This is like its own question now. Well, this one here is tri-substituted. This one here is di-substituted. Okay? So which one's going to be the overall more stable product? Red. Red is going to be more stable than green. Which one is the Zaitsev product? Red. Okay? Because Zaitsev is the more stable one, this one's the less stable. It's Hoffman. Okay? So instead of saying less stable, more stable, from now on I'm just going to be using the words Zaitsev and Hoffman. Because guess what? Those are just synonyms of the less stable and more stable. Just Zaitsev and Hoffman. I can just use those words. Okay? So now we have to figure out which one is major and which one is minor. Which one am I going to form in higher amount than the other? And what Zaitsev's rule explains is that I'm going to favor the Zaitsev product, okay? So that means that this is going to be my major product, and this is going to be my minor product, okay? Does that mean that I only get one of these? No, I still get both, but I'm going to get a lot more of the red and a lot less of the green, okay? Now, sometimes your professor may ask a question that just says, give the major product for the reaction. If they're asking for major product, then you would just draw red. But if your professor asks, give all the products, then you would draw both of them. Does that make sense? But many times, especially in multiple choice exams, if you have any multiple choice component, many times your professor is just going to say, draw the major product, or select the major product. If you're doing online homework and it says, select the major product, it would be this one. Okay? If you're just checking it out on different resources online, this would be the more stable, more favored product. Awesome, guys. So Zaitsev's rule is pretty easy, right? We just use the number of R groups to figure out which one's more stable, which one's less stable, select the more stable one.